Shalom. I'd like to give all praise to the Most High, Yahweh, Bashem Yahweh Shai, Bashem Rakak Wadash. Peace to the hopeful elect of Israel. Double honors to the apostles, the elders, and brethren, a great millstone, and all like minded brothers who are preaching the truth all around the earth. This is your brother, Itazwan Bayah, bringing a short lesson. Okay, Lord willing, it'll be edifying to those that watch it. Found a real interesting article. Okay. Struck my fancy, if you will. This is kind of in my wheelhouse. That being that of history and the history of our people, in this place, okay, that we know is a captivity of ours, you know, since we've come into the truth. And this Jake, more than likely, this man you see in front of you, is 10 times out of 10 is an Israelite. Okay, his name at the time is or at his time was William Harvey Kearney. Okay, and I received certain publications from time to time in the mail, and I saw this article in this particular publication, and I found it interesting. All right, this brother's name was William Harvey Kearney, and as the story goes, was born a slave in 1840 in Norfolk, Virginia, in which, you know, that's a part of the country that I once lived. But anyway, he was educated at a, quote, secret school, end quote, by a local minister, acquiring rudimentary reading and writing skills at the age of 14. Kearney escaped slavery through the Underground Railroad, a network of secret routes and safe houses, and made his way to New Bedford in the Free State of Massachusetts. He and his father, another escaped slave, eventually earned enough to buy the rest of their families freedom from servitude. Kearney worked the docks in New Bedford, a major whaling port, until he heard the call for blacks to join the Union Army. In a letter to the Liberator in an abolitionist newspaper, Kearney gave his account of his motivations in joining the 54th Regiment. So if you know anything about the 54th Regiment, first regiment of so-called black men in the state of Massachusetts, to which they made this particular movie right here from, okay, which was Glory, starring Denzel Washington. Right here, you see in the thumbnail. That was about the 54th Regiment of Massachusetts in the Civil War, you see. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to let this play. I got it muted. If I can get it to play there. But anyway, he joined this regiment in Massachusetts. Okay. It goes on to say, quote, previous to the formation of the colored troops, I had a strong inclination to prepare myself for the ministry. But when the country called for all persons, I could best serve my God, serving my country and my oppressed brothers. The sequel is short. I enlisted for the war, end quote. Kearney participated in the suicidal assault in Confederate Fort Wagner near Charleston, South Carolina. And that's what this movie is about. Matthew Broderick, Denzel Washington, Morgan Freeman. I forget that brother's name right there. He's been in a lot of different movies. Okay, if you've never seen that, you know, that's a good movie to watch. It'll tell you a lot, you see, especially now that, you know, we awake to the truth. I'll go on. Kearney participated in the suicidal assault in Confederate Fort Wagner near Charleston, South Carolina, by the all-black, all-volunteer 54th Regiment Massachusetts Infantry. In the midst of withering fire, when the first flag bearer fell, Kearney took up the regiment's colors and led his fellow volunteers to the crest of the parapet. There, Kearny secured the banner in the sand as the battle raged. When the Federal troops finally fell back after dark, Kearny wrapped the stars and stripes around the pole it was carried on and carried the banner back to Union lines. Despite wounds to his chest, head, and leg, the latter, sloppy. The latter injury so severe that for more than 30 years, he would limp every step of the way as he delivered the mail in New Bedford. As he handed the flag over to other survivors of the 54th, he told them, quote, boys, I only did my duty. The old flag never touched the ground, end quote. And that's a big thing in the military. Those of us who were, you know, psyched in to joining the armed forces, if you will, of this land, you know, not knowing any better. Okay, you know, whether it was Army, Navy, Air Force, or Marines. And I guess you have to include the Coast Guard in that as well. You know, we didn't know any better. Okay. And same thing with this Jake and all them Jakes back then. We were destroyed, right? So let me just quickly jump into, let me finish this up. Okay, it's not much more. For courageous action, Kearny became one of the first black soldiers to be awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor. After recovering from his wounds, Kearny worked a number of jobs before becoming a letter carrier in New Bedford in 1869. Many early letter carriers were military veterans, since appointments often were based on a local political connection, and it was common for a town's prominent citizens, including the postmaster himself, to have served in the Union Army. There were just four letter carriers in New Bedford at the time of Kearny's appointment. He was the only black carrier in the city and among the earliest anywhere. Just 2 years earlier, in 1867, John Curry had become the nation's first black letter carrier, working in Washington, D.C. Kearny carried mail for more than 30 years, and just as he had done in the enlisted for the Union cause, the Civil War hero was quick to step forward when mailmen around the nation decided to band together in the National Association of Letter Carriers, which is a current union of letter carriers. The Charter of New Bedford Branch 18 issued on March 20, 1890, includes Kearny's signature as vice president. In addition to the low branch number of 18, the founding date makes clear that the New Bedford carriers were among the first members of the NALC, which had been founded only 7 months earlier. After nearly 32 years of service at the age of 61, Kearny retired as a letter carrier. He still needed other work because, although he probably received a small stipend for his war wounds, postal employees had no retirement benefits at all. In 1901, the Massachusetts Secretary of State asked him to take the job of messenger at the State House. Kearny accepted the post and held the job until his death on December 8, 1908, as the result of an elevator accident. Okay, so that's the Jake right there. That's the brother right there. Okay, I just found that a little bit interesting because, you know, as slaves, you know, the Israelites were brought over here. Okay, and the Northern Kingdom was already on this side, you see, but he was destroyed. He didn't know who he was, and that was part of the curses. So let me jump right into Deuteronomy 28. Right? The old staple, okay? And I'm going to start at verse 64. And it says, the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods. Right? That flag, okay? That can be looked at as another god, okay? As he said, like he just wanted to do his duty and serve God, right? But he had no understanding of, you know, who the Lord really is, you see. Verse 64, continuing on, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shalt the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord Yahweh shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. And getting back to Carney's story, you know, even after serving and being wounded, you know, he still needed a job. And then after he worked 32 years as a letter carrier in Massachusetts, he still needed a job at 61 years old, even back then, you see. All right, so I'll go back to 65. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord Yahweh shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing eyes and sorrow of mind, and thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, with God it were eve, and at eve thou shalt say, with God it were morning, for the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships by the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again, which is our homeland, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bond men and bond women, and no man shall buy you. Right. So we can't, you know, be free, because nobody, we have to wait for the Redeemer, you see. So let's look a little bit at these two verses here in Isaiah. And I'm not going to make this long. I'm going to go ahead and fire through these scriptures here. But Lord willing, like I said, you know, you can, you know, get some kind of edification out of the scriptures in this man's story, you know, born a slave and then ran to his freedom, you see. This is Isaiah 14:1. For the Lord Yahweh Bashem Yahushai will have mercy on Jacob and will yet choose Israel and set them in their own land, and the strangers shall be joined with them, and they shall cleave to the house of Jacob, and the people shall take them and bring them to their place, and the house of Israel shall possess them in the land of the Lord Yahweh Bashem Yahushai for servants and handmaidens, and they shall take them captives whose captives they were, and they shall rule over their oppressors. Right. It's going to come that day where we're no longer going to be the ones being oppressed. Okay. That this is going to switch. It's going to change. You see. And when you think about it, you know, in the first verse, for the Lord will have mercy on Jacob, we're talking about the 1860s here. Right. So you still talking about over 300 years of slavery before that, because unbeknownst to most people, it didn't start in 1619. It started way 100 years before that and more, you see. So by the time you get to 1869, you're talking about 370 years already. Okay. That's the history of it. If you go back and look for it, you'll find it, you know, because they started that slave trade in the 1500s. Okay, coming over here and getting Israel and taking them back over to Portugal and Spain. See? But there's going to come a time now where the Lord is going to set everything aright. Okay? Jacob will be at rest, and we're going to take them into captivity, okay, because they deserve it for all the hateful and wicked things that they did to us, them and all the other nations. Okay, let's look at Revelation 13:9. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints, and that's what we're waiting on now. Okay, redemption and retribution through our Savior, Yahweh Bashem Yahweh Shai. Okay. Let me look again here at, let's go to Jeremiah. I actually meant to read this one first, before that revelation, but it's all good. Here it is. Jeremiah 50, starting with, I'll start at 33. And it reads, thus saith the Lord Yahweh of hosts, the children of Israel and the children of Judah were oppressed together, and all that took them captives held them fast and refused to let them go. And even, you know, though it's part of the curses, that's how it is. They never let us go. Okay. They kept us here. We still here. All right. Now we know that that comes through, you know, our Father, our Heavenly Father and our Savior, you know, that this is what we have to deal with until he comes and gets us. All right. Verse 34, their Redeemer is strong. The Lord of hosts is his name. He shall thoroughly plead their cause that he may give rest to the land and disquiet the inhabitants of Babylon. Right now, there are those out there. That's Babylon is ancient. You know, you keep reading, you see that it applies to this place. Okay. A sword is upon the Chaldeans, said the Lord Yahweh, and upon the inhabitants of Babylon, and upon her princes, and upon her wise men. A sword is upon the liar, Salakia, the liars, and they shall dote, and the sword is upon her mighty men, and they shall be dismayed. A sword is upon their horses, and upon their chariots, and upon all the mingled people and are in that are in the midst of her, right? The mingled people in the midst of Babylon, right? Is this not so-called the USA, the melting pot of all nations, of all people, of all kinds? Okay. And they shall become as women. A sword is upon her treasures, and they shall be robbed. A drought is upon her waters, and they shall be dried up. For it is the land of graven images, and they are mad upon their idols. You see? And they have so many graven images here. What? Statue of Liberty, stars and stripes, right? That banner, you know, fake white Jesus, whatever it is, they've taken people and made them idols. You know, what was that stupid TV show, American Idol, all those different things. Okay. Verse 39, therefore the wild beasts of the desert and the wild beasts of the island shall dwell there, and the owls shall dwell therein, and it shall be no more inhabited forever, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation, right? Because the Lord is going to destroy this place, okay, with those nuclear missiles, as the Most High overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah and the neighboring cities thereof, saith the Lord Yahweh, so shall no man abide there, neither shall any son of man dwell therein, right? Nobody's going to be here, and we definitely not going to be here. Okay, I'll read the last one. This is Revelation 18. I'll start right there, verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, that ye receive not of her plagues. For her sins have reached unto heaven, and the Most High hath remembered her iniquities. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her works. In the cup which she hath filled, in the cup which she hath filled to her double. Right. They're going to get double the pleasure, double the fun. That's how that commercial used to go. I think it was double mint gum. You see? They're going to get double what they did to us. Okay. Verse 7. How much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her, for she saith in her heart, I sit a queen, and am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire, right, those missiles. For strong is the Lord power who judged her, Salakia. And the kings of the earth, verse 9, and the kings of the earth who have committed fornication, live deliciously with her, shall bewail her and lament her, when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, the great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come. Okay. And the old ancient way, 1 hour wasn't enough to knock Babylon down. So it's got to be talking about this place. Okay. With the speed of those ICBM missiles. Okay, drop it on this place. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth her merchandise anymore. The merchants of gold and silver, precious stones and pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all thine wood and all manner vessels of ivory and all manner of vessels of precious wood and of brass and iron and marble. Salakia, that jumped up instead of down. And cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and beasts and sheep and horses and chariots and what? And slaves and souls of men. William Harvey Kearney. Okay. This brother right here was an Israelite. Okay. Lived during the time of the Civil War. He escaped his slavery, he and his father, and ran up to Massachusetts. They worked, got enough money to buy their family out of the servitude. They didn't get freed, and you know, because you see people, there's idiots out there that would say Deuteronomy 28:60. Oh, no man to buy you. Nobody. No, listen. Okay, as a people, as a nation, we can't get from under these curses. Okay, so that's not the same thing. Okay. This brother here, he went into the military in that movie Glory. He was a part of that regiment, okay, that went to Fort Wagner in South Carolina. I think it's Charleston, South Carolina. Stormed the beach in the Union Army, you see. And he was a part of that movie Glory, or took part. It's like, yeah. Took part in this flag, okay, bringing that flag up, as it said in the article. All right, William Harvey Kearney of the 54th Regiment of Massachusetts, okay, first regiment of so-called black soldiers, okay, he was an Israelite, but he didn't know that, okay. So right there, I'm just going to leave the lesson right there. You want to know more about him, I guess you can research it and look it up. But I just thought it was an interesting article. Okay. I'm just going to leave it right there. All right. Hope it was edifying to you. Hope you can get something out of that and get something out of the scriptures. Okay. And I'm going to end right there. I'm going to give all praise to the Most High. Yahweh Hashem, Yahweh Shah, Hashem, Rekar Kodash. Peace to the hope of the elect of Israel, double honors to the apostles, the elders, and brethren, great millstone, all like-minded brothers preaching the truth all around the earth. I'll see you again with another lesson real soon. Shalom.